Hey guys, welcome back to the What's Next podcast. I'm your host, Steveblasen, coming to you right here from Monterey, California, right here on the beach. Beautiful day. Today we've got an amazing guest today. He came in yesterday for a massage and we got to talk and we just talked about everything. Mr. Richard Uzzell. Welcome, Mr. Richard. How are you?
I'm doing fine, and thanks for the invitation to come in. And it's, you know, a little bit unusual for to be invited to come in to speak and to be considered to be called amazing. But thank you for doing that. I'm just a just a regular guy.
I don't know. We talked about a lot of different things. I guess you were like in the army. You were you're a bass player.
Yes.
I said, yeah, bring your guitar in. I'd love to hear some. You know, that's kind of a first for this program.
Well, thank
you. A musician in with his guitar.
Well, thank you. Well, it's good to be here. I guess I've had a lot of hobbies in life.
Sure.
One of them is beekeeping, and one thing I've been looking for is to. Expand beekeeping in this area. I did a lot of beekeeping back in North Carolina,
Where
I was, and I understand that there's a demand for that in maybe some of the olive orchards and some of the places like SS. You know, I guess when you get old, you learn that sometimes, you know, hobbies are the key to maybe. If not making a living, at least contributing to one of the many sources of income which we have to have these days, because sometimes your 9-to-5 job doesn't cut it. And so, you know.
It's funny you say that, because I was just watching on YouTube the other day about beekeepers and how they move a hive. And they'll just look at it and go, oh, there's the queen. Pull it right out. It's like, how'd they know? You know, and then they just follow. They put it into another hive, and slowly the hive just kind of transfers on over.
Yeah.
That's really neat.
Yeah, it is. It's I'm not at the level of beekeeping that a lot of these folks are. I've seen some people in my home state of North Carolina, a place called Chapel Hill. That's where the university is. But they have this thing. It's a shop vac that they've converted into a thing where they can just vacuum the bees in and put them in, and then they take the queen and put it in a little thing about the size of a matchbox. And then they put the queen in the new apiary, and then they just shake the bees out of the shop vac, and they're just happy because it's their queen that they know already.
Oh, it didn't kill them?
No,
didn't kill them going into the shop vac? Seems
no.
Like you throw them against and...
No,
say,
it's
wow, that's fantastic.
No, yeah, well, they figured it out. These guys figured it out a way to do it that, yeah. I mean, it's in their best interest to keep the bees alive.
Yeah.
But it's also you use that shop vac. I mean, it takes a large number of bees away very fast. I mean, I made the mistake one time of climbing up a second story ladder, and a neighbor was moving in and said he's got bees and he was going to get someone to an exterminator to come in and kill them all. I said, don't kill them all, and let me see if I can get them. But it was a swarm. It was probably about 100,000 strong. It was under the eaves of the house.
I was on the side. That overhang was just packed.
I was a little bit greedy, but I went ahead and I said, okay, I want to get these bees. So I started cutting the wax out and all that. And the bees, when I cut the wax out, the wax was falling on the ground. And I was fine because I was in my bee suit, but my veil came detached from my suit. And I literally had bees in my bonnet. And
really?
And I climbed down the ladder from the second story, walked across the field toward my house. And I stopped counting at about 9 stings. And I thought that was going to be it for me. I asked the Lord to just take me on across the river if it's going to, if this is my time. But my hands swelled up. The bottom of my feet looked like some kind of terrain map on an army topographic map.
Not funny. I don't mean to laugh.
No,
man,
no.
You must have been dancing.
I was just lying down on the ground, just waiting to go to the pearly gates.
Yeah,
but
tell me, you've got. I asked you when you were in the massage room. You've got a southern accent.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you came from Louisiana, and you said North Carolina.
That's right.
I don't think of North Carolinians have such a deep Southern accent, but I've been there enough times to, once you said that, it's like, oh, yeah, yeah, you're right. It's definitely Southern.
Well, southeastern North Carolina, yeah. And it's, there are a lot of places in North Carolina that have really marked accents, like around Ocracoke Island. They call them the Hoytoid accent, and they say that it's the accent that's closest to the language of Shakespeare. They've been there for Ocracoke Island is where Blackbeard, the pirate,
sure.
Was. That was his territory, and so a lot of these people have just been there. Just generation after generation, and Blackbeard was around, I think, the end of the 1600s, and a lot of people have been there a while.
Yeah,
that island's not going to be there much longer, though, as a result of sea level rising. But
well, it's come up about 5 inches in the last 200 years. I don't know how fast it's going to come up in the future, but at that rate, it'll probably be here for a while.
Well,
what do I know?
I think it's just maybe a foot or two above sea level now,
and oh, is it really?
And it's in Hurricane Alley too.
Oh, sure.
Hurricanes pass through there, and
sweep
every
right
time
away.
A hurricane comes through, those dunes get washed away, and they do beach renourishment, and there's usually enough money from real estate developers who see that if they pump sand into the island that they can still keep getting their rents.
And, right. So, I guess that's the key, right?
Money is always a carrot.
Follow
for. We all need it, and I don't know, but it's kind of like Benjamin Franklin said, "He who says money is not important will soon be asking you for some."
Sure. So, right. Right. Yeah. Fooling his money part quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. But
well, we were shooting the breeze the other day, and it comes up that you speak Russian. How
yes.
does a young man from North Carolina learn how to speak Russian?
Very interesting. I grew up in a small town called Burgall, North Carolina, back during the turn of the century. When I say the turn of the century, I mean from the 1800s to the 1900s. There was a large influx of Russians to southeastern North Carolina.
I see.
Entrepreneur named Hugh McRae, who turned out to be there's a book written about him. He turned out to be a big white supremacist, but he advertised 12 acres and a mule because he was trying to get white immigrants to come in to North Carolina to help convert these big pine forests into arable farmland, which they did. They're big blueberry. There's a lot of blueberry production there, a lot of tobacco there. And how did he advertise in these East European newspapers 12 acres and a mule. He fulfilled his promise, 12 acres and a mule.
And they were forest.
Pine forest.
And you had to take the forest out in order to farm on it.
That's right.
You and get the 12 acres, right?
Yeah,
to work.
Yeah, and they put a railroad track through there, and the railroad ran from it's been since the railroad track's been taken up, but a track went all the way to Raleigh, and I guess all the way to California after that, so all the way across the U.S. So,
yeah, right.
I grew up next door to the Zawaskis and the Mazariks, and some of the first words I learned in Russian were profanity.
Sure.
Of course, that's the first thing that every kid
In case we have Russian listeners, we won't go there.
But it's forbidden fruit, and forbidden fruit has been interesting all the way from the time of Adam and Eve.
Sure.
But when it comes to what got me interested, the whole since I'm 62 years old, and I was a child of the space race, and the
yes.
Apollo-Soyuz competition between the Russians and the Americans captured my imagination, and I put together the models of the space capsules and lunar module and all these things. And and the whole dynamic between Nixon and Brezhnev, I can remember those. I remember thinking of Brezhnev as a very scary fellow. And I also remember things such as that I recognize as propaganda in the cartoons. And I remember being a little bit offended when I would see Rocky and Bullwinkle, this moose and squirrel always outwitting these Russian spies who have obviously shown success. I mean, Russian spies have been very successful throughout the years, and to say that a moose and a squirrel could outwit them, you know, was a little bit silly. And I love my country, but I was a little bit embarrassed whenever I would see that they were trying to pawn it off on the Canadians and saying, oh, it was Dudley Do-Right, the mounted police, and say we weren't even taking credit for this children's propaganda that we were propagating at the time. But to continue with that, I continued to study Russian, and I'd sit on the – my brother brought a Berlitz Russian book from the public library, which I would sit on the beach and I learned the alphabet. I don't know why, just because it was Russian or something.
Sure,
you know,
right.
It made it seem, you know, scary, or I'm doing something dangerous.
And, kind of. Huh?
But I continued to studied in college, joined the Army. I went through interrogator training, and I studied Russian at DLI here in Monterey. And I also was stationed at Fort Ord when I was in the Army.
Oh, were you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Since Clinton, I think.
Yeah.
That's a while ago.
Yeah. I remember Leon Panetta was our representative at the time. And I think, wasn't he the Secretary of State under Clinton?
I was still in Michigan at that point.
Okay. You know? Okay. But I think he was. But yeah. I remember he had Leon Panetta had a good reputation back then as someone who took care of business. And I remember he helped a guy who came to Fort Ord who his son had committed suicide. Mm. And the kid is a sergeant who had five kids, and the kid left a suicide note, said he just wanted to leave, have one less mouth to feed in the family. Mm. And I can tell you, back during that time in 1983 to 1985, it was tough on soldiers in the Army. And I remember, you know, being a private and having a hard time making ends meet. Luckily, there was a mess hall, it was a lot of thin times and belt tightening.
Back right, then. Exactly.
Yeah. But
sure was.
I don't know.
You went so far as to learn. It's funny when my dad, he's gone now, but I think he got to be about 75 and 80. And he picked up an interest for Russia,
mm-hmm.
and he read everything he could possibly get his hands on.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, God, what a boring thing. I couldn't, you know, make sense of it. But as I got older and you start learning more about Russia, it just goes back forever. You can just study and study and study as much as you want the way through, you know. So now I'm starting to get a little more interested in it. But at the time, I was like, that's crazy. So that's what you did. You know, fell in and
mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, there's so much. I mean, you go back all the way to the, I don't know how far back you want to go. I mean, the story of how Christianity came to Russia is really one of the most fascinating stories ever. In the year 989, a guy named Vladimir the Great, Prince of Kiev, and it's kind of interesting how Putin has seemed to forget the fact that the written Russian language came from Vladimir, the Grand Prince of Kiev, from Kiev, and it's not the other way around, as he has been trying to say Kiev has been a province of Russia. But
it's actually the other way around.
Yeah.
I see.
As far as a written Russian language anyway, I know that in 989, in the year before 988, he was tasked with finding a religion for his people because he was sick of, you know, seeing these people with all these pagan ideas and superstitious beliefs. And so he tried to get some kind of codified religion, which, took them away from the house imps and all these kind of bizarre mystical things, you know, that were not healthy for his society. And so he went on a voyage. He went on a journey to find an official religion. He was the czar, so he had the power to do that. And he first of all he checked out Islam. And he said there's no way the Russians are going to accept Islam as an official faith because they love their wine too much. And they're going to, he rejected that out of hand. And then then he checked out Judaism. He said, well, what about the Jewish faith? And he said, these are people who really don't have an anchor, and they're wanderers. And my people are fastened to their land. They're fastened to the Russian land. He rejected Catholicism.
So that didn't fit either.
No. Right. He rejected Catholicism. He said that it didn't work either. But he saw an Orthodox. He went to Greece and he saw an Orthodox ceremony there, and he said the grandeur of the Russian Orthodox Church and faith and all the icons and the gold and the onion domes satisfy the Russians' appetite for beauty and grandeur and ornate. It's beautiful, and they will accept that and they will take it. And so he now some of this is a little bit of legend mixed with and we don't really know what's true. But one of the greatest parts of the story to me was Vladimir went and talked to the Greek Orthodox. I guess he was I don't know what they call him in Greek, but the head of the church. And he said, I want to adopt this faith for my people. And he said, well, you're going to have to come to Constantinople, a modern day Istanbul, to be baptized. And he said, oh, no, I'm only going to be baptized in Russia. And the guy said, no. And so he said, okay, I can solve that. So he took an army with him, as the story goes, conquered Constantinople for one day so he could be baptized in Constantinople. So it was Russian for a day. And he didn't take over the Constantinople or anything, but as the story goes, he came with enough troops to say he was being baptized on Russian land, and then he went back. And one of the most interesting parts of the story is still coming up, because when he went back, he went to the cliffs of the Dnieper River, and he commanded all the people to throw their idols into the river. And, of course, this was terrifying to these people who had been kneeling and worshiping and believed that these things had power. And as the story goes, threw all these things in the river. And he also started throwing people into the river. And many people died. And he said, well, we're baptizing them. And if they survive, it's God's will that they survive. And if they don't, well, that's also God's will.
Humans.
That's interesting, because that's how by bringing the scriptures to the Russian people, he also brought, the Greeks were, the Greeks, unlike the Romans, agreed to translate the scriptures into the Russian language, and thereby gave them an alphabet. They didn't really have an alphabet before this, and so by giving them the scriptures and giving them a language, unlike the Romans who insisted everything be kept in Latin, the Greeks did not insist that things be kept in Greek. The Greeks gave the Russians a language which they could write and communicate in. I mean, they had already been communicating, obviously, by word of mouth. And So as a result, the Russians developed literature quicker than the other Slavic countries, such as Poland and Czechoslovakia, whose primary religions before then had been Catholicism.
Right.
Their writing was using Latin.
Latin, sure.
And
right.
The Russians got about a 200-year jump in creating their own literature among the other Slavic countries and other Slavic languages. And, words are power. I mean, you look at why have the Jewish people been so successful? They've had a written language for a long, long time, and they've had scriptures for a long, long time, and they've established laws. Many of the origins, as I understand it, of even American laws right now are based upon common law during the time of the Old Testament.
Sure.
So,
right.
So yeah, it's so words are power.
Very interesting stuff.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, we just got to make sure, as always, even to this day, that, you know, we police the people who are controlling the words. And it's, I mean, they say some of the first real propaganda was from Cardinal Richelieu back at the earliest, right after the printing press had been created. And I can't go into that a whole lot because I don't know that much, but I've I recently read a book called Как работает пропаганда, by that means how propaganda works. And I can't recall the name. I didn't expect to be talking about this today,
but you never know where this show is going to go.
Right. But you know, the history of propaganda, it's really a fascinating thing. Tamara Edelman is her name.
Okay.
Tamara Edelman. And, but it's, a fascinating book, and it, just kind of talks about things ranging from how the KGB, or currently the FSB, the Russian FSB, has, you know, creates this we and they situation. There's and if somebody does something that is not what we do, then they automatically become a they. It almost seems like a tactic in what they call it, borderline personality disorder, or
really?
Something like that. Just, but yeah, I mean, and you know, you can see it in our own country. You know, people have become tribal.
Yeah.
People have become tribal,
right,
in a way, and that is, you know,
propaganda is still rocking and rolling. From both sides. And
oh, no doubt.
And China, North Korea, whatever. You know,
yeah, not in our own country.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And you know, people have to get back to, you know, just finding a common language. And you know, the good old there were good old days when you know, the liberals and the conservatives, at the end of the day, they go drink a beer together, and they might cuss about how the liberals are, and the liberals might cuss about how the conservatives are, but at the end of the day, they both enjoyed drinking a good beer, or you know, whatever they did, shooting a game of pool, or you know what, and
right,
and going to the church supper, and you know
their ideas were a lot closer together.
Yeah, it was almost,
know, I think, right.
Well, it's
definitely
built in
differences, but
well, it's built into our we're almost programmed for it. I think I remember my uncle who came back from Vietnam, my favorite uncle, Marvin. He came up to me. He goes, "Are you Ford or are you Chevrolet?" And I said, "What?" I said, "I'm a little boy." And he said, no, "Are you Ford or are you Chevrolet?" And I said, "I don't know." He acted like it was a big secret. He looked all around and goes, "I kind of like a Pontiac." And like, he didn't want to tell everybody that he was a Pontiac man.
Right.
But yeah, but, you know, and it's, you know, a lot of times I think people are just built to, geared to this kind of divisive tribal,
sure,
thing. And we as people have to recognize that, you know, there's a beauty in our differences. You know, they've always talk about America being a melting pot, but I think really the best thing is this whole thing about maybe it's a better for America, look at America as a tossed salad, you know, that,
right,
you know, there's, you know, you have, you know, some maybe Greek olives here. You have some tomatillas there. You have, you might have some, fat back chopped up in there or something like that, and, you know, a kind of a celebration of, you know, we are rich in our diversity, and if we can, you know, learn to, you know, love each other that way, and, you know, just respect that, and that, you know, he looks different and acts different, but you know what, you know, he's my brother, and you know, and you know, we, you know,
it's in our human nature. You know, I had a fellow, guy that I've known for years and years, he was saying that we've got to come to a point where we're not prejudiced anymore.
Yeah.
And I said, I don't know if that's a learned thing. I think that's maybe partly inside of you. And he's like, no, that's a learned thing. And I was telling him, maybe I've told the story on the podcast before, but I remember watching an interview with the guy that did the Planet of the Apes. Mm-hmm. And he said, man, there was Chinese and there was Mexicans and there was white and black and all these people. Mm-hmm. But they were all dressed up as four different, you know, a monkey, the chimpanzee, the orangutan, and everything else. Mm-hmm. And we called for lunch. All the chimpanzees would sit together. All the gorillas would sit together. Mm-hmm. But they're all different races inside. Mm-hmm. But they just felt comfortable with who they looked like or something. It was kind of he was saying it was a really neat kind of thing to watch.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean it. I think it is part of our basic, you know, you're a little more comfortable around people that are more like you. Mm-hmm. you know, so.
Yeah, well.
Definitely something you can get around, obviously, but.
Yeah, well, there's that saying, the birds of a feather fly together.
Sure, right.
And I heard somebody say that, you know, that you go out into the field that the white cows hang out with the white cows and the black cows hang out with the black cows. I never was ever really around cows enough to notice that. I raised chickens, and I did notice that a lot of times the buff Orpingtons would hang out together and the Delaware chickens would hang out together. And but they would also hang out with each other too, so sure. I couldn't really come to any kind of conclusion that, you know, there was really a truth in the birds of a feather flock together or not. I know that you know, they say and you know, as I said, I'm from the South. One of the most segregated places on the planet is a church on a Sunday morning.
Really?
And you know, I mean, hey, I'm you know, you got your black churches, you got your white churches, and I'm not saying that's a bad thing or
that's
not.
That's okay.
I mean, because really, one of the greatest places where I would say African culture is kept is where you go into the churches where the old folks are, a lot of the black churches there, and you know, it's a different cultural experience, and it's something that much closer. The music and you know, the swaying and the dancing and the you know, it preserves a whole lot of heritage that people don't talk about. They point the finger and say racism, but well, guess what? It's also kind of a cultural test tube. And just as you hear, you know, and I have to say that, you know, growing up in a Presbyterian church, you know, which was a very white European church, that, you know, all the hymns with the Mozart, you know, tunes and all these things, you know, they preserve the European culture in a way that much the same way that the black churches keep the African culture. And, you know, there's something beautiful about that, too.
You bet.
But, you know, that said, as I sat and looked at sang those hymns, I mean, I sang them and enjoyed them sometimes, but a lot of times I looked at that long pew and said, God, sure like to take a nap on that thing. yeah, it's and I think whatever church anybody's in, you know, everybody gets tired sometimes.
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't want to get too far away from the Russian. I want to get
back
to
that. Yeah, sure,
now,
yeah.
Tell me about, now you're talking about the written language, and it seems like I've heard, of course, you've seen the written Russian language.
Yes.
It's a whole separate type of letters.
Yes.
Is there two separate alphabets?
Yes. Good instinct. Yeah, there's, it's called the Cyrillic alphabet.
And I see.
Because there are these two Greek monks, Cyril and Methodius, who combined the Greek alphabet and the Latin alphabet to accommodate the Russian sound system, because there are letters in the Russian sound system that are not in Greek. There's one letter in the Russian alphabet that makes the CH sound, like the CH, whereas we have two letters in English, or the SH sound, they have one. And they also have one this, some textbooks say is like SH, as in fresh cheese. And and so, you know, So yeah, yeah, that answers your question.
Very interesting. So in our talk, we talked a little bit about Russian mobsters and gangsters.
Oh yeah.
You know, I didn't touch on it too much because I don't know much want to talk about it. Do you feel comfortable with talking
about it? Yeah, I can talk to you about that. Sure. Yeah. Heck yeah. Yeah.
So how did you come across this? Obviously military, huh?
No. I was over there as a private business person. Actually, I went over there. A guy read an interview of me in the paper where I said this was in 1990. I said I was teaching Russian in a high school at the time, and they interviewed me because it was kind of an anomaly for Russian to be taught in a high school in North Carolina. And they interviewed me, and they said, well, why would anybody want to study Russian? I said, well, look, I mean, the Iron Curtain's fallen. The grocery shelves are empty there. I mean, you've seen the bread lines in Russia on our TVs, and it looks like to me there's a great opportunity for American business people to go over there and fill those shelves with our own products. And if we don't, the Chinese, the Germans, the French, all these people are going to get there first. So that's a real good reason to go. So this American businessman read the it was picked up by the Associated Press, this article in just a little small town weekly newspaper called the Randolph Reporter. I think they published four times a week, and the Associated Press picked it up, and so he got it down. He heard it down in Wilmington, North Carolina, which is a port city, and you know, he said, do you have any interest in going to Russia and doing business? And you know, after having studied at DLI and speaking Russian, I had no background in business, but I said, you know, what the hey, you know, I was 30 years old, and let's try something new. And
let's do this.
Yeah, and so yeah, I did. And and while I was there, I found out that there's a long story. I can't go through all of it right now, but I got over there, and one of the first things we did was we had to help these people convert their government dwelling places into we had to help them privatize them so they could sell them. And so we did some real estate work there and remodeled these old communal apartments, which were you know, there would be four families living in one apartment and sharing a kitchen and a bathroom. And we had to do negotiate individual contracts with each family. I remember once I bought an apartment that anybody who knows anything about St. Petersburg, Russia, knows that when I say the address of my office was Nevsky 3 and the Tsar's palace is Nevsky 1, that we found a piece of choice real estate. And I paid for it in cash. I negotiated one contract for one room for $32,500, and I carried it all in cash. I stuffed it in my boots and in my old army coat, and I took the subway and tried to look like Lieutenant Columbo.
Right.
And so I went and paid and counted out. And you'd be surprised at just how small a space $32,500 and $100 bills will fit. But, you know, you can do it. And but in any case, we bought some real estate, started renting some stuff out, put a steel door up on our office, and we got a visit from some people that came to us who are offering us security. And they told us stories, and I'd already heard about how, I don't know if it was a Mercedes or a BMW dealership had been firebombed there, and I was told that that happened because they refused to pay for protection.
Mm.
So,
now what was this, like a warehouse that you had bought up that you could store, I don't know, groceries, the type of thing that would go into a grocery store, or what exactly were you bringing in?
We brought in a number of things.
The real estate.
We had several aspects of our business. I brought a forklift over there. We were trying to just be ready. Any things that we could buy in North Carolina for cheap, we bought dry cleaning equipment. because they had outlawed the use of perchloroethylene dry cleaning equipment in North Carolina, I think in the whole U.S. But dry cleaning was in such dire straits in Russia. I mean, people would come back from the dry cleaners with melted buttons, the dry cleaners would cut the buttons off, and sometimes they were very haphazard. They cut the material. And so we were trying to go there and bring American business, or just profit, a profitable way of life. And in the eve of capitalism, or at the beginning of capitalism, there, and be among the first. Well, what happened was, since Russia, for almost the entirety of the 20th century, had been a command economy, a communist economy, where the government, everybody received a government paycheck. And many people who are old enough to remember when Reagan went over there and hailed these people hawking T-shirts on the streets as heroes of capitalism. These are the people who became the oligarchs, and many of these people who are, the billionaires in Russia today, they started out by black market dealings. Well, what happened was they came to us, and some people came to us and offered us protection, and we said, we're an American business, and we're just going to do this honestly. We don't want to deal with any kind of corruption or black market or anything like this, that. And so they said, they made it very clear to us that if we didn't pay them for protection, that we were going to need protection from them.
Right. I think that's what happened to the Mercedes dealership.
Yeah. So I called my boss and I said, listen, man, I don't think this is going to be worth it. And he goes, pay him. It's the cost of doing business.
Went in Rome, I guess.
Yeah. And right. Well, here's the thing. Since the economy had collapsed, teachers were not getting paid. There was even a joke about privatization. People working in the Kalashnikov factory would say, privatization is the way to go. And so they would steal a firing pin or one piece at a time and say, I'm privatizing this. And so it was, government property that they were stealing and privatizing. Well,
sure.
People who worked in the mayor's office, teachers, and since they weren't getting paid, they would, parents, I knew a guy named Idris who said, I haven't got my check, Richard, for the past 3 months. I said, well, why do you even go to work? He said, well, we're able to make it. And what happened, the parents would bring them what they could sell, and these teachers would have to go stand out in front of the subway and sell bottles of vodka in order to, or they'd trade vodka for whatever. Yeah.
Sure.
Everything had collapsed. So
right.
That was the kind of thing that we were dealing with. And so if you have to pay some people for protection, and these people will protect you from the so-called tax police whenever it comes time to file taxes.
Ah, I see.
So you could, not only do they protect you from, other people coming in and breaking in your doors, but also whenever it comes time to file taxes, that these people are going to also, grease the wheels, because they have what they call the government mafia.
And, oh, really?
Yeah. There were five different major mafia groups that I can remember when I was there. There was a group called the Tambovsi, which was based in the city of Tambov. There was a Jewish mafia.
Really?
Yeah. There was the government mafia. There was a Chechen mafia, which was known to be really the most brutal of all.
I've heard that one.
And,
yeah.
And there was another group, which I can't really remember, but there was also, they have what they called reket, which was just kind of like the low level, just people on hoods on the street who might control this street corner. Those are the ones who I ran into whenever I was trying to open up a dry cleaners in St. Petersburg.
I see, right, yeah.
They
gangs more than mafia.
Yeah, pretty much. People who want to get their what do they call it when the mafia comes and asks for their cut, each time their percentage, there's a word for it. I can't remember
what
the word is, But
they're cut. We'll go with that.
But in short, we never did open a dry cleaners there because we were. Yeah. I dealt with. It was my first. My driver who almost got into a fight, but luckily the guy knew he had met his match. My driver, and I feel funny talking about having a driver and a bodyguard, but I did at the time.
You needed it, right?
Yeah, but he was a Spetsnaz foreign officer in the Russian army. He could throw knives and all that stuff. His arms were as big around as my legs, and you could look at his knuckles. He from doing knuckle push-ups or beating on a wall or whatever. It was serious. It was a different time, and let me just. A lot of people don't understand too why democracy has such a bad name among Russians right now. They have this word "dermokrati," which basically means shitocrats. And what happened was during Yeltsin's time, Yeltsin, unlike the Chinese, he just said, "Let's just do the." Massive, just let it all happen. Let's let it let the market go by itself. And what happened was there was no structure, there was no organization, and it just created anarchy. And so the person with the biggest stick is the one who was in charge, and that's what they have today. And I remember walking to work every day and just seeing some really tragic things. You know, I already told you about the schools and how they had fallen apart.
Yeah.
But I remember seeing a girl about seventh grade age sitting right outside the subway selling beer and drinking beer.
Oh, geez.
And, you know, instead of going to school every day. I also remember seeing some of the most, I'm not a person who reads porn, but I remember, you couldn't miss it when you'd walk out on the streets and these people would be holding up these just horrific things. It was just pornography combined with violence. I mean, bloody violence.
Really?
And this put associations of democracy in the minds of many Russians who were there.
Oh, I see.
And they'd say, so if this is what democracy is, if this is what freedom is, that's not what I want.
You don't want it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no kidding. Mm-hmm. So you talk about being a writer. Do you write about? What do you cover when you write?
Well,
I thought you said maybe you had a book in the progress.
That's true.
So tell me a little bit about writing and then.
Well, most of my writing in the past has been working for newspapers, being as a journalist.
Oh, okay.
But right. They not any kind of big newspapers.
Sure,
weekly newspapers, small town newspapers. But I'm writing a book right now. I haven't gotten a title for it. I've written about 18 chapters about my dealings with the mafia. And
with the mafia? Kidding.
Dealing with the mafia in Russia, just a homeboy from North Carolina meets the Russian mafia.
What an interesting subject.
And, well, thank you. There are several things that are kind of stopping me from finishing it. One is the fact that my accountant was murdered when I was there, and I just kind of feel like I owe it to him to find out what happened. It feels like that I need, in order to finish that book, I've got to find out what happened to Sergei Valentinovich.
Yeah.
I was told after I left, because I left with my son because I was afraid. It was just my son and me living there at the time. And I was afraid. I was just happy when that plane left the ground. Actually, I was happy when we landed in the West and we touched down in Frankfurt. I found out afterwards that he had been killed. And I just wondered if people were trying to find out if he had access to money, which our company had, and he may have, you know, died telling them protecting my name just telling the truth.
Sure. Right.
I'm stuck right now because I've been back to Russia since then. Five times. I've investigated on my own. One guy said, don't go there.
Don't get hurt.
And this was a guy who was a former partner of mine and who I wonder was if he was complicit in the whole thing. But
Well, that kind of stuff can eat you alive, brother. You know, don't try not to dwell on that too much.
Well,
you got your life to live still.
It's true. And, I'm 62. I've lived a good life. And, you know, I'm not afraid to die. And
clearly neither was he. You know, he was protecting you, and he was willing to die for it.
Maybe. You know? I hate
He's
the thought.
He's a badass, right?
Well, right, but I just hate the thought that, you know, that somebody made that kind of sacrifice for me.
Yeah.
And I don't know that that's what happened. Maybe I'm romanticizing it.
Sure, right,
but,
right.
But he was a good fella. And actually, I had to fire him for drinking on the job, too.
Yeah, that's a Russian thing. I'm drunk, too.
In Russia, I don't know if they do it in this country or not, but they have these kind of subcutaneous ampules that they put under the skin that releases this kind of like antabuse or a drug which makes people virulently sick whenever they drink alcohol.
So he had
that done, but the medicine had evidently run out, and so I caught him drinking champagne. I could tell he was slurring when he was talking to me on the phone about the bills. And I went and, caught him drinking. And it was sad. You hate to fire somebody.
Sure, right.
Especially somebody who's a good person.
But they got
with a sickness, you know. Yeah. And alcoholism is a sickness, too. My father was an alcoholic.
Yeah.
And, you know, I loved him. I wouldn't want anybody else to have been my father.
Sure, right.
You can't be doing the books in a business while drinking.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I got a lot of years of sobriety, so I'm no one to throw stones. I had my bad times, you know. I know the sickness. So, well, we talked about beekeeping and writing and Russian, and there's a couple other things we talked about. Anything else you want to talk about before we're going to probably take it out with some music?
That's about it. But you know, I appreciate you know, giving me a chance to just speak my piece and share with people. And a lot of people don't understand about Russia, and there's it's absolutely a fascinating place. And I'm just afraid to say. Very, very sad day for me when Alexei Navalny, when we found out that he died, because for me, he was a big hope that, he was martyred, as have been many Russians, like a guy named Sergei Magnitsky. And I think there will be monuments dedicated to these men at some point once they have a solid judiciary and, you know, they will get on their feet. They will get on their feet someday, but it won't be for a while.
Well, we got this stupid war going on over there, and our population is split so hard right down the middle. And you hear so much news, but you don't know really what's what. You know, you watch the Tucker Carlson interview, and seems like Vladimir Putin's basically just trying to keep our military off of his borders, you know. And, well, that makes sense. We wouldn't want to have Russia putting air bases in Mexico. You know, I get that. But then I talk to people like you that know a heck of a lot more about Russia than I do and say, well, he's kind of going after this area. Oh, okay, I don't know what I'm talking about. So can you give me kind of quick overview of what's going on over there, or are you familiar with?
I'm familiar with it.
I don't think he just bulldozed over. What's the one? Ukraine.
Ukraine. Well, I'm
unprovoked. They say. I don't know if that's true. What do you think?
Well, this is getting into an area that is a divisive area. I do have my opinion on it.
Right.
I'll say this: Ukraine was a sovereign country, there are many Russians who look back at the days of the Soviet Union as the good old days, and they forget. Stalin lived a long time ago, and a lot of people forget the abuses of Stalin. And I think.
Stalin kind of made Hitler like a bully at a playground compared to how many people he killed. And they were mostly all Christians, weren't they?
I think just these, to put any kind of rhyme or reason on Stalin's, what Stalin did other than his own self-interest and his own fear, I think it is, I don't think there's really any rhyme or reason except self-preservation.
Really?
And as far as what's going on in Russia and the Ukraine right now, I will say I'm against the war.
Sure.
But I do think that I read John Bolton's book, and we cannot allow Putin to run roughshod over everyone, and it's.
Now, was Kamala Harris there a couple of weeks before he invaded, trying to get them into NATO? I mean, that's what I heard. She was giving speeches, you know, we want to get you into NATO. And people say, well, it was a sovereign country. And I don't know how sovereign it was because, I mean, they've had military or United States backing for a long time. I'm talking out of my ear because I don't really know what I'm talking about. These are just the propaganda that I hear.
Well, I don't know anything about no. I don't think there's been any offer of NATO. Maybe they may have been offered a chance to become part of the EU, but that's different from NATO. There has been talk about that, but I don't think Kamala Harris doesn't even have the she can't make that offer. That's not within her. Can't do that.
Exactly.
But I will just say that there should not have been a war. Putin invaded a sovereign nation, and we're staying out of it. We're not putting any boots on the ground. And American intelligence was spot on whenever. Biden said there are 100 people, 100,000 troops standing on the border. What do you think they're doing? A training exercise? Heck no, it wasn't a training exercise.
No.
They were getting ready to invade. And I think one thing that you can bank on is American intelligence, American military intelligence, especially when you look that he gave it didn't really make the American newspapers that big or American news that big, but just within the past 10 days, there was a big mass shooting in Moscow. And we warned the Russians that the Islamic State was planning an attack in exactly that part of Moscow. And they ignored it. One thing that you can count on is the American taxpayers can be happy that our intelligence services are the best in the world. I really believe that. And I think hopefully that's something that will bring all Americans together, that you know, if we can win wars with intelligence instead of bullets, let's do it that way.
Yeah, that's the idea.
But I hope that works. But you see, you want to hear some music, I'll be happy to play a couple of songs.
Well, I sure appreciate you coming in today.
Hey, thank you.
You know, you gave us an insight of a lot of different things, and that's what we were looking for.
Well,
unbelievable.
Well, thank you.
So what kind of music do you usually play, and what kind of music do you play it on?
Instrument. I play rock and roll. This is an original song here, and this is one I have to give credit to my cousin Jeff, who came up with the whole concept of Space Force Girls. And I'll play that song for you. I hope you'll enjoy it. And I'll grab the guitar.
Well, that sounds fantastic. We'll take a quick break a minute, and we'll let Wade get all the audio and set up. I know he brought his guitar in too, so he may back you up.
Okay.
I don't know. I'm really looking forward to this.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you again for coming in, sir.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's a privilege.
Oh, and when you get a title for that book, and once it gets going, I want to hear back so we can talk about it.
Thank you.
We always put a link to everything, but you're just not quite done with it yet.
Right.
We'll do that.
All right.
Once you're done.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, guys. Love you.
The name of this song is Space Force Girls. It's an original tune. And The concept is from my cousin, Jeffy Boy. Thanks, Jeffy Boy, for this concept. Space Force Girl, Space Force Girl, Space Force Girl, coming back to your city. Space Force Girl, coming to your town. Space Force Girl could get some astronaut takeout. Space Force Girl's gonna be splashing down. Goes out on missions, always takes off her press-ons. She got a kitty named One-Eyed Jack. She always carries an extra set with her in case some inoplanetarian jumps on her back. Space Force Girl, Space Force Girl, Space Force Girl. Don't forget her man when she go out on mission. Bring it back some space girl love every time. Last time she came back, she brought him a moon rock from Ganymede. Space Force girl, keep her man feeling fine. Space Force girl, Space Force girl, Space Force Girls. Thank you, thank you. This is a song called Sharks Breakthrough. It's by my buddy Nabil Conda. But here we go. I told you clearly late last week that the sword will fall from high. Decisions should be made, battlelines drawing earth, all the crazy lies. Signs were clear, the talk was dark, the streets were filled with fire. Life as we know it, baby, don't you blow it and burn on a funeral pyre. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do when the sharks break through? Open your empty mind. Open your empty mind when the sharks break through. Sharks break through. The story has been told again and again, why don't they ever learn? Killing all the people who've done no wrong is a height of arrogance. You gotta make those bombs that fill the air with acrid burning smoke. Lungs made for breathing, to live a simple life becomes a deadly joke. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do when the sharks break through? Sharks break through! Sharks break through! Sharks break through!
Thank you.
Thank you. This song is called The Ancients. This is an original song made with my cousins and all hanging out in North Carolina in my barn one afternoon. And so... lots of things. They were ancients. They were super beings. Living in Atlantis. Morphing into fish. Exercising wormwood and granting every wish. Well, they had lungs. And they had gills. And they had cures for many ills. The younger ones grew little wings, which they spread at the Seven Springs. Thank you. Well, I knew a dude named Tinker, an Atlantean, an ex-drinker. A lifetime ago, he died in Sobibor. In this life, he's a carpenter, and he saw green in my aura after smoking some marijuana. The green meant that I had problems with jealousy, but his cure made it go away. Well, thank you. Thank you, guys. Well, it's, you know, it's, pays to have a hobby sometimes. It may not pay, but it'll get you through, get you tired and help you go to bed and bring you a little peace.
Can two of you play together?
What's our feel going to be?
It's going to be 1-4-5. I'll go. Said, don't be the dog cause you're mad at me. My baby left me a letter. Said, don't be the dog cause you're mad at me. But she be kissing on the dog, but she won't even look at me. She tore up our wedding picture, threw my face in the trash. She tore up our wedding picture, threw my face in the trash. I don't know for sure, but I don't think that girl's gonna be coming back. I know you're my loving man.